podcast. We're here. We're doing it. Oh, it seems like it's a classical. This one that we got here
today. Yeah,
right. I'm just waiting to see if you...
You're looking at me with, like, the pregnant leader, and I'm like, yeah, yes it is.
I was waiting for, like, an acknowledgement.
What, in your estimation, makes that classic?
Mostly because it's we're dealing with a frog boil.
Yeah, oh,
there you go.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah.
We sure as fuck are.
I like it when you take the animals and just mix them kind of like that. You make your own little chimeras. I like that.
I do, but I can't take credit for it.
Oh, really?
Credit will be given as credit is due at the appropriate time.
All right, man. Well, this week we're talking about suburban horror, the Bluefield Frog Boil. When a frog and a gargoyle, not necessarily two things you really want to see come together because it's snaky and big and have weird eyes.
A lot of times I think it's already been done. I mean, first off, I'm not going to go down this alley too far because I know I've been down before, but I have to say, as a kid, I lamented after seeing the made-for-TV movie Gargoyles, which is one of the top-notch and terrifying. And
for sure.
Yes, I agree. That they aren't based on real-life demonic entities, but they're just like an architectural sort of edifice. They're just something used to like scare demons away from churches and water.
Yeah, they're super cool drainage.
Absolutely. And from, again, an architectural point of view, fantastic, but from a kid who is obsessed with mythology point of view, dead kick.
Yeah.
Like, gargoyles were never supposed to be real. All this other cool shit, minotaurs, fucking mermaids, all this shit was supposed to be real, but not gargoyles. But to get back to the point, a lot of them kind of look like frogs. They have big open mouths.
Yeah, we have a friend that actually builds a super cool gargoyle.
Oh, yeah, right on or something?
Yeah, it's dope. The guy, I should ask him where he got those, and I should put some in my front yard. Because I have plenty of room now that I have no more mulch. It's all stone. I can put some gargoyles out there. Not in the roof.
But to protect.
Roof's new.
Protect the kids.
Yeah, protect the kids with the giant stone gargoyle. I don't know if you're pulling over that, but we'll see what happens. Regardless, let's get started with the Odysseys of Youth are fraught with perils, both real and imagined. But for one curious young boy, his obsession with a pair of eccentric neighbors and their odd property would spiral him into a surreal vortex of crazy cryptids and what he believed were occult rituals.
This is a Cinemax store that's right now.
You're predicting ahead.
Oh, my God, I'm doing
it again. Yeah, you're doing it.
That title just describes...
100%. No, it's a slippery slope in general, but segment, you know what? Without the ados, let's enjoy it. In our reality, 1985's Fright Night.
That's right, Chris.
1985's epic Fright Night, as written and directed by Tom Hall, is a rollicking tribute to the Hammer horror films of the 1950s and 60s, particularly the dynamic between Peter Cushing and his frequent on-screen nemesis, Christopher Lee.
Yeah, it's a long story, but definitely for Patreon.
It's with a healthy dollop of Hitchcockian voyeurism, all swaddled in a classic curiosity kill the cat scenario with great beauty special effects and a fun 80s teen pop vibe. Now, imagine what might have happened if, following the resounding flop of this epic 1984 adaptation of Doom, had to be referenced soon enough, Columbia Pictures had tapped visionary filmmaker David Lynch to come in, rewrite, and direct Fright Night. For any film fanatic, the mere suggestion sends one's imagination into a frenzy of possibilities. Perhaps young Kyle Blackman could have been recruited to the pivotal role of the teenager, Charlie Brewster, who, in an almost Beethoven-like fashion, finds himself slipping into the seedy underbelly of an otherwise bucolic burg by the slow rolling of a great and wild mystery. But before I find myself slipping into the specific rabbit hole, where I'll almost certainly parse the minutiae of what it might have been like to have had Dennis Hopper essaying Chris Sarandon's role as the vampire next door, Jerry Dandridge.
That's a great fucking casting, too, totally.
Let's pause this on an experiment and agree that whatever the results may have been, they would have almost certainly been fascinating. And here's where I come to the subject of this week's episode. The Bluefield Frog Boil. So named by the prolific crypto chronicler and much neglected researcher, Cole
that new phone,
Cole.
Son.
I know.
You can FaceTime Cole.
I really should.
You should.
Yeah.
Bro. Come on.
I gotta learn to designate.
Yeah. Cole, if you're listening, contact Robert immediately.
Jesus. But back on point. Like in the movies mentioned above, it's an account of one youth's fixation on the strange goings on next door. But instead of a teenager being swept up with a sensuality and violence underlying their otherwise quiet town, as was the case in both Fright Night and Rudolph, it's the story of a curious child, his utterly oddball neighbors, and a strange little monster who forever etched itself into his memory. And for all those playing 80s split bingo, this last chip can save with one E.T., Gremlins, Critters, Ghoulies, Hobgoblins, or God fucking forbid, the Munchies.
It's all the Munchies! No one ever thinks about the Munchies!
I think about the Munchies.
Do you really?
And I'm not pleased. I wish they occupied zero space in my head.
Oh, man. Although Ghoulies? Yeah, oh, Troll, dude. Troll 1 and Troll 2.
Troll definitely could have made it.
Yeah.
I mean, Troll. I like Troll genuinely as a movie. I like it better than Ghoulies.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Ghoulies is sort of one note.
Yeah.
But Troll has like alternate worlds and crazy things happening.
The little mushroom guy that sings.
No budget Tolkien, you know?
Yeah, man. It's kind of like House Part 1 and House Part 2. Both have a huge spot in my heart. And it's hard to pick which one.
Well, I mean, for me, one is the only
one. Yeah.
Two is the miserable.
No, two's fun, man. Grandpa's he's the cowboy.
I know.
And the skulls.
They got a lot of density.
Oh, like, got super density.
Like, yeah, then we got the three, and it's just Muppets fucking galore. I'm like, bruh. It's all
like, the pterodactyl alone, you're like, Jim, wow, sever. All right, well, Robert, let's have some more cheese.
But before we begin, let's figure out where we are. Nestled near the southernmost point of West Virginia, just over 150 miles southeast of the notoriously monster-infested Point Pleasant, and the surrounding environs, all of it was really riddled. But GeoCities lingers, doesn't it? In the darkest corners, covered in light and regret.
I don't know.
Right next to Angel Fire.
I kind of wish that portion of the internet still existed.
Me too.
But,
dude.
I mean, it's out there somewhere, man. It's going to use the way back.
There you go.
That's
always there.
The internet was a better place.
Social media.
Dude, when we were running the American Monsters forums, getting hacked every other week.
Every other in it. The only games you can play is like if you connect with people and like, you know, here's a bunch of letters and you had to make a sentence. Like, remember that fucking thing?
I do, yeah.
Way back in the late 90s or whatever it was.
Do.
Right. And then you just voted on like 20 spots.
Yeah,
and
no,
you
I do remember that. And then I remember playing like Quake Arena. And I'm like, I'm playing people across the world. And then I realized that.
According to Robert's account, as a boy, he and his family moved to a house in a great deal of silver, Newfield, on Long Island. assuming that what's over the fence is worth pursuing.
Yeah, good point.
Hitting her bond was never enough for me.
Yeah.
Like, just because you want me out, I'm going to decide whether or not I'm going to take your bond.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. I always look for a hole in the fence, or if you real fucking break
somebody's
nose.
Oh, boy. Yeah, that's when the breaking gets into the end, right?
Yeah.
That's where it gets dangerous.
Make yourself a little hole, dude. Whatever, and then just put it back up with bolts in the sand. And they'll leave it there.
Or somebody just puts too big of a chain on the gate, and you're like, you know, my bad ass can slip into here. You prevented nothing from happening.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a lot of leeway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They didn't like the slap right. Exactly.
Yeah, you didn't both chain quick.
So, anyway, this kid gives 0 points. That's established. Robert is headstrong and intrepid. Let's go.
He's my kind of kid. He's out there doing fucking possibly leading shit around.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, yeah. Good.
It's trespass.
Yeah,
well, he's good.
He's
going to be rap man.
Really?
Yeah. He'll be like, I'll burn and fucking wire.
What a shitty steroid. Oh, it sucks.
So you like fences.
He just kind of
we have such things to show you. You're like, no, show me.
You will itch for eternity.
Just draw it. Just draw it for me. Please let go.
Emerging through the other side, the first thing Robert noticed was an array of multicolored witching balls. Something that I've seen, I guess, but is new to my experience. And I found out more about them today than I ever thought I'd know.
Oh, okay. I don't know what these are.
Well, according to Cole, they are things that were put up by farmers to destroy. To the gate of Black Ranch.
Huh. Okay, I'm gonna...
Okay, so I know what all those words mean.
Right.
But, like, what exactly?
They're just, like, these colorful glass balls.
All of light.
Approximately the size, not necessarily illuminated, approximately the size of a bowling ball, or maybe a little smaller. And they're called witching balls, I guess. Sometimes you see them on a pedestal, and sometimes they're just laying around the yard, I guess. I've never seen them on moss.
Oh, like, shit! Sure.
Which I mean, obviously, yeah, since Jack Waters, I love the irony of that it was just some lawn shit people put up, like a
garden.
Yeah, or like that random jockey, which I never quite understood. But
I didn't realize that these were like, this was like even a thing. Oh shit. Okay, I mean, yeah, actually, my mother in law is
now. Right
now? She's keeping the black man, she's got to go to fucking woman's house. Never heard.
So, the first thing Robert noticed is, which in fact, is the multicolored witch balls that got. But his attention was quickly drawn to the yard's main feature, a large, likely handmade pond that was surrounded by the swirling orbs. By swirling, I mean the swirling orbs.
You're
not actually swirling around.
So far, so fifth kid, Jack.
Fascinated, Robert threw caution to the wind, and instead of sneaking around the perimeter, he began openly walking through the strange display of art and nature. It was at that moment that he caught a flash of movement from the corner of his eye. It was the vague figure of a balding, middle-aged man staring out a bedroom window. The young witness would later compare the man to Alan Blunt, the kind of camera.
Who are you talking to right now?
Yeah. Who uses Alan Blunt as a point of reference?
Thus,
no one.
Making it clear why I suppose this was a 70s or 80s sighting.
I mean, literally, all of our listeners right now.
Okay,
that
makes sense.
For sure. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, even many people our age, it's not necessarily a ubiquitous cultural phenomenon.
No.
Candy Camera was a big show.
It was, yeah.
I mean, that fuckers
yes.
Understand the caveat of Candy Camera.
No, it's
fucking
hilarious.
It's like fucking fun.
Yeah.
But yes, now it makes sense for that time.
Okay.
For sure. Because nobody.
Yeah. No, that's definitely.
Was,
that's a point in time, dude.
Definitely. Only, he had a large burn mark on his head and face that looked like white paint had been splashed over. So he's got a non-pigmented segment of his head and face.
Yeah, absolutely.
The other significant difference between the two men was that one's usually jovial countenance had been replaced by no, it's just a fun name to say.
I just
what's up, fun?
Oh, I just can't.
Play music and we're going to funts. Kick around the old whatever the fuck it is.
Funts being a real bitch.
Probably.
Yeah, funts got a boulder and he's taking pictures of us doing dumb shit. It's more funts than getting a bread line.
Depression era.
Depression era funts. Oh, Jesus. Yeah.
Strangeford Park? Okay, you're a little kid, you notice it was no big deal. People look different, that's fine. Sneaky grin replaced by a look of fucking fury?
Yeah.
What is going on?
No, because it goes from like head to
that's
real piss, real creepy.
Yeah.
Really though. Well, maybe if it was just a full sneaky grip, if that hit linger, it might have been worse.
Yeah, it was a rage, at least a rage.
Yeah, but Big Man's just like, old man yells at clouds. Just,
sure.
Grin, like,
yeah.
And then the head, like,
but then grin right. Replaced by rage, it's like the worst set of both.
Yeah,
words.
Right.
It's way worse than either of those ever. Just as the furious man burst out the back door, screaming for him to get out at the top of his lungs. Scrambling through the dirt, scratchy, low-hanging limbs, and prickly wire, the boy luckily could not help but be shouted by the urgency of the man's voice. This wasn't just a desire for privacy or the maintenance of a child-free sanctuary of work. No, his tone seemed to express an odd combination of anger and genuine fear. Almost as if not just to make anxiety, but to get away from it was too late. That's the tone. Okay, that's a weird patina.
That is, especially when you're like, this is what falls in a homemade pound for fucking dip. And then this guy's just yelling at you.
Yeah.
Trying to swim, man. That's the fucking break.
Man, just be holding your feet.
Yeah, good. There you go. You know? It ain't hurt, man. Well, if it was my yard. Like, get the fuck out of my yard, you little bastard. You son of a bitch. How dare you?
Right, do you have a yard? Do you probably have a yard? Go to your yard.
Yeah, go to your yard, asshole. Yeah.
Wow.
You know, which pond?
Get your goddamn feet out of my goddamn witch pond. Funt said so.
Well, the Funt says, you listen.
Yeah, dude, fun.
Yeah. I love this duel between Mark's childhood personality and his adult
I know, really.
he's not hurting. Get the fuck out of here.
I've never yelled at any children in my yard. I only yell at the cats in my yard because they spray my goddamn face with the window.
There's Jerome. Why does
she have windows? My cat's in the basement, so she's outside fucking with them, and then she comes in like, fuck you, I got a nice little spot to eat, so cool, and I get to yell at this fucking asshole. And then she sits in the fridge, the cat comes to the window, and then sprays the window trying to like get it. And this cat has balls and antlers. It's huge. I mean, this cat's big, pair of balls are seen on it.
Unfixed.
Oh, yes.
His wife, though, hangs out on the rest of the
show. Okay, I might get a hold of that. I'm not sure whose kid this is, but it's fucking all of us.
The ball snipping cult?
Yeah!
A little alarm.
So I don't yell at people, I yell at cats.
Back to the story. Breathless, Robin rushed to his house, hoping no one caught sight of his escape. But luck was not his ally. Within seconds, there was a pounding at his front door. His mother answered the line to a red-faced neighbor screaming that their son was to never, ever enter his yard again. You really are. His mom agreed that her son's exploits were a breach to the heart and finally held the poster hand up enough to leave with the assurance that it would not happen again. For his part, Robert was likely given a stern talking to and maybe even was grounded for telling. Though not specifically cited, whatever his punishment may have been, it was significant enough to dissuade the boy from further expeditions through the hedgerow. Or a bit, anyway.
See, because you gave him a challenge.
Yeah, you don't do that.
No, man.
He didn't do it. He just put it out.
He just went out in the yard and was kind of hanging out.
I mean, okay, fine. Sure. So you didn't, like, throw rocks?
No.
Yeah, it's not like he was, like, kicking around the witch balls, trying to smash them.
Yeah, throwing those balls in the pond, taking a shit in Funt's pond.
That would never have gone over.
Dude, that's what that kid's gonna do.
Wow. I feel like that's an old saying. Like, that's about as popular as the kid who shit in Funt's pond.
I should be now, dude.
Yeah.
There you go.
Let it catch on.
That's
no one ever.
That's atheism right there.
Jesus Christ. No, I will not be credited with that. Let that little phrase be anonymous.
No, man, I don't know.
Funt's pond.
Dude,
dude, shit, this is morality. That's ridiculous.
shit once upon.
Let's do that.
You see, you're nailing it.
Yeah.
You're nailing it.
It's a phrase now.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, only the three of us will use it.
No, not our listeners will use it as well. Okay.
All right.
Shit.
As time went on, Robert found himself fascinated by his uniquely performed neighbor and his equally eccentric employer. Like 12-year-old Eugene Walters, inquisitive lead in the 2006 animated horror flick Monster House. And I say not children's film. That's a full-on horror.
Monster House is awesome.
Agreed. Robert was becoming obsessed with his strange neighbors. At night, the couple would sing Christian hymns into the wee hours. But these were not the gentle inspirational ditties that issued forth from houses of worship. They were discordant cacophonies, screamed almost blasphemously loud at the top of their lungs, accompanied by a piano that seemed like it was being played by a toddler with a hammer.
Does he do their impression of hymns just by the words then?
I don't know if this kid's a Christian and he heard him in church. Or if it was like he asked his parents what they were singing at some point, and they were like, they're hymns, dude.
I like
but
that doing
I don't know what.
Loud and terribly. It was like, Jesus, smashing the fucking piano and shit.
Like just beating the keys.
Yeah.
And it's one thing if you can't sing, but you're, you know, passionately religious, and you just want to, like, you know, just carry that ode to God as loud as you can.
Neighbors are definitely going to fucking.
But when you know you suck, and if you don't know you suck, you know your significant other sucks. So even if you're under the delusion you're good, you know the person who's singing with you blows.
Yeah.
But you're both doing it as loud as you can, and neither one of you can play the fucking piano, and you're doing it anyway.
Yeah. Or singing.
I mean, yeah, dude, you know?
That's extreme.
You're drawing attention to yourself, dude. Especially as a neighbor, you gotta be, you know, noise, mate. You don't be too loud for your fucking neighbor. You gotta be respectful of the people around you. Ask what they like.
Not if you were doing that. Not
no,
if you were
I
were scream, shouting.
Every so often I get hammered, I break out the fucking karaoke speaker and we carry over to the backyard. But we invite the neighbors over, like, come on, we're singing with us.
Of course.
And it's fun.
That becomes a bond band.
Yeah, it's a little too late. Like,
of course you do.
Yeah.
Your legs shortened by 6 inches inexplicably.
Yeah.
And you just get on your knees and sing.
I was like, down the road, girl, down the high.
You can deadlift the tractor.
Yes.
But only until you're done singing.
All right, man. Yeah.
All right. All right. Robert also played with her man's playful often parade around the yard with her tank top around her waist, displaying her mastectomy scars, which actually sounds pretty badass. Like, fuck you guys. I mean, we have topless laws in New York since the 80s. And to my chagrin, I've never once seen a woman publicly topless. But that having been said, it's fair. If guys can show their nipples, girls should be able to show their nipples. It's universal. It's a given. Like in state parks and stuff, I don't know about city streets, but I remember reading it as a kid in the like local paper and going, well, hot damn.
You say city streets?
I will enjoy excursions to Fillmore Glen,
yeah.
Watkins Glen, fill in the Glen, a lot more.
You just wait until you see a bunch of topless, toothless drug addicts in front of the fucking Hewitt County office building. You're going by and be like, well, I wish I had shirts on.
Oh, sure. Sure, there's limits to every desire.
All right, but
and bear in mind, this is a 12-year-old's delight, not a fucking 51-year-old's reality.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
So,
right,
so there was that. So she's doing it, and you know what? I mean, she got her scars.
Yeah,
wear
she's
proudly,
like, fucking whatever.
Do it whatever. Yeah. So it is what it is.
Yeah.
But ultimately, it did nothing to endear her to the neighbors. Next, Robert, any situation that would have worried his parents had they been more attentive, and clearly they were not, took to climbing trees to smile the couple, adding that often during the winter months they liked to bathe in the buff.
In the winter months?
In the winter. To me, that's the sin. Like in your own yard, you got a big hedgerow, let it fly. Do what you want to do.
Are they European?
I mean, I can't swear they aren't. It's the fuck face, a European face.
Is this hell like a European thing? Like, do Vikings do that shit?
Sure.
You know, it's cold, but like fucking unique.
I mean, the Germans certainly do, because they give 0 fucks.
Yeah, all right, man, well.
Free with their
money. And this kid is climbing trees and fucking peeping on it.
That's the more disturbing issue here. Not the nude sunbathing in their own yard.
You shouldn't be climbing trees and peeping at your neighbors.
Yeah. you end up having to write things that you are uncomfortable with. But it is a fact of the case, as written by Robert S., and so I'm putting it out there.
I mean, you know, that's what kids do.
Truth be told, the only truly offensive thing they're doing is the fucking late-night fucking camp session.
Yeah, it's your own backyard. Yeah. They have a hedge. Their hedge is like their own privacy. So you're back in whatever they want. Not like the little house boat.
Right. Established, at least in New York State, park watch. Do what you want.
You can't be walking around.
I mean, I'm like, if you're like out on your porch on your property and you're just hanging with the
I think maybe yes.
I don't.
But I would think if your dick's in the wind, there would probably be a decent exposure in your future.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Okay, what if it wasn't a dick? What if it was a vagina?
I think it depends on how conservative your neighbors are. But none of us are experts, clearly.
No.
I have no idea.
We can, like, call our lawyer real quick and just be like,
wouldn't be worth the just hundreds of dollars.
Just curious.
I want to just sit on the steps with the boobs hanging out.
Yeah, listen. Nick's in this weird shit. She's got these new vampire books that she's going to read. Things get weird.
We haven't found out just before.
Amazon finally fucking delivered her, what was it, Filthy Rich Vampire?
I can't believe that's the title.
You're going to come home and she's going to have a pair of teeth.
And she's going to be like,
here you go. That's her voice. she likes to read books.
God bless.
Yeah.
And literacy should always be encouraged.
Yeah.
No matter how depraved.
Even if it's weird vampire
or piss poor it is.
Weird vampire.
I love her and I'm glad she's reading. And that's wonderful.
Sure, sure that is.
All right. Okay. So, Nate, what it was that so intrigued which comments on here? What he claimed to have since the first time he trespassed on their property? Sense that something was quote-unquote wrong with the neighbors and their land, which, despite their strangeness, only exacerbated his fascination. In his story, Harold wrote, quote, the peculiar nature of his eccentric neighbors was not enough, however, to dissuade him from once again approaching the property. And on one particular summer's day, he would come to regret not staying. The day in question, Mark was playing just outside the edges with a bunch of matchbox cars. Not that I ever gave fucks about cars, but somehow every kid gets matchbox cars.
Yeah,
just a few.
Yeah, but I went right for like the Star Wars thing.
Sure, so did I.
I mean, I had matchbox cars. It's because I had like a cool track. Oh no, I had a grave digger.
It's inescapable. If you're a boy of a certain generation, you own a matchbox car.
I got my kid matchbox car. Like, yeah, here, check them out.
Well, because it helps hand-eye coordination with your kid.
Yeah.
It's motor skills.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't mean anything more, really.
Yeah.
Either way, I'm saying it's something we can all identify with. He's outside playing with matchbox cars. And he was startled by a sudden rustling of the bushes not far away. So this means, and I have to put this out, that Robert still fucking around in the neighbor's yard because the hedge neighbors are two neighbors over here.
Yeah.
So he's still not just fucking playing in his own goddamn yard with his own goddamn toys.
He wants to hang out.
He is 1 yard away by the hedges, the verboten hedges.
Yeah.
Oh, I wish we had a name for that.
I mean, he's keeping an eye on this.
Right. And that's his deal, obviously. A voyeuristic eye.
He's
a little uncomfortable eye. But yeah.
He's
startled by a sudden rustling, trying to stand. The boy made his way toward the shaking shrubs, and what he saw next would haunt him for years. According to his account, he was peeking through the bushes when, without warning, a strange face emerged from the foliage. The creature was unlike anything he'd ever seen before in books or movies. In fact, the closest comparison Robert could make was with that of a stone gargoyle. Well, not slouch. Okay. You're gonna be a Frogoil. Or a Frogoil.
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 In the Queen's English.
Is there a documentary about Frogoil?
Well, here's open. Yeah.
The negative reviews.
The eyewitness with the stick. This essentially bulldog shape. Iridescent green. Potentially bellicose beast is having jet black eyes that bulge from his head in a decidedly frog-like fashion.
Frog eyes. Boom. I like it.
Right. Hence it being dubbed.
The Frogoil.
There it is. Its large ears both flex outward from the sides of its head like two big gloves. So that's, what's the amphibian thing? The one in Minecraft. Axiotl? I always say it wrong.
Axiotl?
I know my 5-year-old nephew pronounces it flawlessly. And
right.
I've always just, as all words, just harshly. So whatever that fucking amphibian is with the big frills out the side
okay,
and like hands waving like full on jazz hands constantly.
Oh.
This is what this thing is.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's interesting.
Iridescent green.
Yeah. So it's like metallic, very vibrant, was described also. And its stumpy limbs terminate in webbed feet that turn dead. So it's working. It's
like it's pigeon toe or something?
Pigeon toe. It's like imagine a bulldog.
Okay.
With slippery, bright green skin, slightly metallic shoe grass, the big, lovely frills on the side of its head.
Yeah.
Bulldog shape, like I say, stumpy legs, turned inward, webbed feet, a big mouth, we'll be dealing with that in a second, and bulging, like jet black eyes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yes. It was then that the whole thing opened its wide mouth, revealing an array of finger-length teeth that seemed outward as its long stretched open.
Oh, that shouldn't be a thing.
Yeah, the teeth just
this thing was
out.
This thing was already kind of goofy, but I know, like, oh,
yeah, that's weird. And big giant teeth.
Yeah.
It then let loose within its 28th season. Then as if to, quote, taste the air. It's an interesting animal, though, because it's like, it hisses.
Dogs do that,
and he's writing about it later.
Yes.
He's like,
yes.
Just like right